So let me introduce our speaker, Dr. Madhadeen Bansal. So Dr. Bansal is an assistant professor in the Electronics and Communication Engineering Department of PDPM, Indian Institute of Information Technology Design and Manufacturing, Jodhpur, India. He obtained his PhD from IIITM earlier in the area of wireless communication. He did his BTech and MTech in Electronics and Communication Engineering. Then his teaching and research interests include wireless communication, resource allocation in wireless networks, NOMA. He is also a life member of Institution of Electronics and Telecommunication Engineers, IET, and a senior member of Institution of Electrical and Electronics Engineers, IEEE USA. He has published more than 20 research papers in reputed journals and other conferences. He is a reviewer of many reputed research journals and conferences. So Dr. Bansal is going to speak on basically tricoder design in MIMO cognitive relay network, a case study. So over to you, Dr. Bansal. So please go ahead.
Thank you very
And
much, sir. Thank you very much.
I hope that your talk is going to benefit all our participants. So please over to you, Dr. Bansal, please.
Thank you very much, sir.
Can you share your slide, please, now?
Yeah, please, sir.
You guys share it? Yeah, thank you.
Just Just a minute, sir. Just a minute. Just a minute, sir. Okay. Can we able to see my screen? This PPT, energy efficient tricoder design for MIMO networks.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay. Thank you. So we are today we are going to discuss the particular problem of tricoder design in MIMO cognitive relay networks. Basically, I am going to present.
Dr. Bansal, can you just make it large by pressing Control L?
Sir, it is large, I think.
I think Control press Control L once again. Is it possible?
Okay. Okay. No.
Control L. Okay, ma'am.
Yes, sir. It's large, sir. Actually.
Okay. Okay. View large is there. Okay. Okay. Fine. Okay. Please go ahead. Normally it comes to Control L actually. Okay, it's all right.
Yeah, Control L, sir. It's full screen
okay,
actually.
Okay. Okay. Go ahead. Please carry on.
It's actually PDF, sir. Actually. Okay. So this is a particular problem of tricoder design in MIMO cognitive relay networks. This is the work of one of my students, published in Wireless IEEE Wireless Communication Letters. I will show you the MATLAB programming of this particular work as well as how we have extended this work by solving this work with the AI techniques, particularly the deep learning technique, right? So these are the key points by which we will cover this topic: introduction, then motivation for this work, particular objective of this work, system model, and the numerical results, conclusion, MATLAB programming, and references. Right. So presently, you all know that with the advancement of this wireless technology, millions of devices are connected wirelessly, right? And the cellular networks are expected to accommodate around 50 billion devices by the year 2020. It's already passed actually, and which requires around 100x higher data rates as compared to the previous generation or the 4G mobile systems, right? So in future, we can expect that the wireless networks will provide very high data rates, and the demands for high data rate, low latency, and the systems will improve device connectivity, right? And the aim will be to reduce the energy consumption, right? So the design of future networks or wireless networks particularly have to face some major challenges. And the first and foremost challenge is the availability of the spectrum, right? We need huge spectrum. That's why we are moving towards the higher and higher spectrums, right? 4G is working on around 2 GHz. Then in 5G, we are expected to move in the millimeter wave range, right? And second thing comes is the effective utilization of the available resources, right? Resource allocation is a key point. And then the third one is energy efficiency. Energy efficiency is very important performance metric in designing wireless networks, right? So this particular work addresses these two problems, the utilization of the spectrum as well as the energy efficiency, right? According to the Federal Communications Commission, the licensed spectrum is underutilized, or the licensed spectrum is not used in an efficient way. Right. So to reduce this problem of underutilization, or tackle the problem of the underutilization of the licensed spectrum, a concept of cognitive radio has been proposed, right? So in cognitive radio, the so-called unlicensed users, or called the secondary users, use the licensed spectrum of the primary users in an opportunistic manner. That means when there is an opportunity, the secondary users are allowed to use the licensed spectrum, but without affecting the operation of the licensed user, right? And there are different modes or paradigms in which this cognitive radio concept works, right? One is the underlay cognitive mode, the other one is the overlay cognitive mode, and there is an interweave cognitive mode, right? In the interweave cognitive mode, actually, whenever there is free spectrum, whenever there is a spectrum hole, the secondary is allowed to use that spectrum hole for its own data transmission, right? In the so-called underlay cognitive radio mode, the secondary users are allowed to use the license band simultaneously with the primary users, provided that the interference created by the secondary users on the primary users is within some limits, or you can say the performance of the primary user is not degraded because of the secondary users. And in the third or overlay mode, this overlay mode is basically a win-win situation for both the primary and secondary users. In the overlay mode, basically, the secondary users is allowed to use the licensed spectrum, and in lieu of that spectrum uses, secondary do some relaying or some other work for the primary users. All right. So this particular work is focused on the underlay mode of cognitive radios, right? Where we will allow secondary users to use the licensed spectrum of the primary users, such that operation of the primary is not affected or not degraded, right? The second point or the second technique which we are using in this work is the relaying, right? Relaying is a technique which is leveraged to improve the quality of service in terms of capacity, reliability, coverage, energy efficiency, and to reduce the interference at the primary users, right? And there is one more technique, which is the multiple antenna technique, right? Or the MIMO, right? in the multiple antenna technique, basically the transmitter and receivers are equipped with multiple antenna elements, right? And these multiple antenna elements can be used in a variety of ways depending on how you are doing the signal processing, right? They can be used to enhance the capacity of the link by the so-called spatial multiplexing, different data streams, right? Independent data streams. So the capacity of the link can be enhanced, or you can use that these multiple antennas to beamform or so-called precoding, right? So that by you can have your directed transmission, right? You can form the beam with these multiple antennas in a particular direction. So definitely when you have a focused beam, a very narrow beam, the interference on the other sides is negligible, right? Which is required in this particular case. If the secondary users are using multiple antennas, they can cancel their signal in the direction of the primary user and simultaneously using the spectrum, right? And so basically this is the interference suppression capability of the MIMO, right? The MIMO antennas can also be used for diversity gain, basically to increase the reliability of the communication link, right? Whereby the same data is transmitted to multiple antennas, through multiple antennas, right? So there are different benefits by which you can for which you can use the multiple antennas, right? But these advantages of multiple antennas are not mutually exclusive, right? That means you cannot use multiple antennas for spatial multiplexing, interference suppression, and diversity at the same time, right? There is a trade-off between them, right? So if you are using some degree of freedom for spatial multiplexing, then the degrees of freedom for diversity will be reduced, right? So there is always a trade-off between in this technique, right? It is the system designer's task to decide the which capabilities of MIMO it wants to use, right? So next, the motivation of this work. You all know that the demand for data rate or the capacity is increasing day by day because of lots of applications like home automation, entertainment systems, connected devices, machine communication. There are lots of applications happening around which all requires very high data rate, very high capacity, right? And this high capacity demands also results in energy consumption, high energy consumption. It is a report. There is a report which says that by 20, there will be around 20% of the world electricity consumption. ICT will account for around 20% of the world's electricity consumption by 2025. And this is very huge amount, right? Only ICT will consume 20% of the world total energy consumption, right? So this increased energy consumption not only results in operational costs, that means money-wise, but it also has impact on the environment, right? Because this energy is generated with the coal or fossil fuels and so on, and they all are contributing towards the carbon emission, right? So this energy efficiency is a very important performance metric, which is being considered for the design of 5G networks as well as for beyond 5G and 6G networks, right? The 5G networks are not fully energy efficient network, but it is a vision for the 6G networks to be highly energy efficient, right? So energy efficiency, you can roughly define it as the amount of energy consumed while receiving or transmitting unit amount of data, right? Transmitting or receiving unit amount of data, or you can divide, you can define it as the ratio of the rate, right? The data rate divided by the power consumption of the system. Right. So in this particular work, we basically consider a MIMO cognitive relay network, right? MIMO cognitive relay network. So we are basically integrating all these three technologies: MIMO, cognitive radio concept, and the relaying concept, right? And we are designing the relay precoder matrix for the secondary system, right? Relay precoder matrix for the secondary system, such that the energy efficiency of the whole secondary system is maximized, subjected to the constraints that the transmit power at the relay remains within the available power, and the interference which is created at the primary user should be less than some preset threshold, right? So these two are the constraints. Our objective is to maximize the energy, right? And our the variables which we want to calculate are the precoder weights at the relay. I think the problem statement is clear. All right. So this is our system model. You can see here there are these two nodes are there. This is the primary transmitter and this is the primary receiver, right? And both primary transmitter and primary receivers are equipped with multiple antennas. We have denoted with this MP, right? So there are MP transmit antennas at the source side and same MP receive antennas, right? It is not necessary that you assume equal number of antennas at the transmitter and receiver side. They may be different as well, right? Because in this particular work, we are interested in the secondary system, right? We are interested in the secondary system, not in the primary system, right? So this is the primary user, which has the license to use the spectrum. And this is the secondary system, which has no spectrum, but it will utilize the spectrum, the same spectrum as the primary is using. The condition is that it's the secondary's operations should not affect the operation of the primary. For that, we will take care in the system design, right? This is the secondary system. So secondary system has a source with m number of antennas, right? We have a relay. We have a relay with n number of antennas and a secondary destination, right? And here the secondary source want to transmit data to secondary relay with the to the secondary destination or receiver with the help of a relay. Why the relay is needed in this case, right? Relay is very important. Suppose relay is not there, right? Suppose relay is not there, in that case the link distance will be more between the secondary transmitter and secondary receiver. So secondary transmitter has to transmit at higher power. So when it is transmitting at higher power, it will also create higher interference at the primary receiver, which the primary receiver may not allow, right? Because its interference constraints are violated. So, but if you place a relay in between, right? In this case, the source can transmit at much lower power because the link distance is reduced. Right? Then it further amplifies and transmits. So in both the cases, the interference can be managed at the primary receiver, right? So these are the different channels. The primary channels, this is the primary channel, right? We are not interested in the primary channel. We are interested in the secondary channel as well as the interference it is creating, right? So this is the interference channel from the secondary source to the primary receiver. And G2 denotes the interference channel from the relay to the primary receiver, right? And this is the channel H1 between the secondary source and the relay, right? And H2 denotes the channel between the relay and the secondary source, right? These dotted line represents the interference created by primary source at the relay and at the destination, all right? So this is what I have told you. We have assumed that the secondary transmitter, secondary receiver, you are equipped with this number of antennas, right? So these are the symbols, M antennas at the secondary source, N antennas at the relay, L antennas at the destination, MP antennas at the primary nodes, right? We assume that no direct link exists between these two, right? Secondary transmitter and secondary receiver. There is no direct link. And the relay, nature of the relay is it is an amplify and forward relay. It simply receives the signal and forward is to the transmitter, right? With some amplification factor. And here the amplification factor is important, right? Because it is also the precoder weights as well, right? So there are different types of relay in the cooperative communication literature. Like you have an amplify and forward relay, you have a decode and forward relay, you have a compress and forward relay, and this amplify and forward is the simplest one that is used here, right? So this H1 is denoted or represented by this complex number, complex basically a matrix. It is a n by n complex matrix, right? This channel basically represents what type of physical channel you are modeling, right? So this E may be, this H may be a simple Gaussian, but the Gaussian, if you assume that H is the Gaussian channel, it will not going to represent the true wireless channel, right? You at least have to assume that H, these coefficients are Rayleigh distributed, right? So this is how to generate the Rayleigh distributed random variables in MATLAB. So basically we have assumed that all the channels are Rayleigh distributed channels, which represents a wireless channel in a particular case, right? And these similarly, these interference channel G1 and G2 of the dimension MP by M also represent also the Gaussian channels, Rayleigh distributed channels, right? And here there is an important assumption, right? This assumption is very important, and we assume that it has practical implications, right? We assume that the channel is state information of all the links is available at the secondary transmitter and secondary relay, right? When you have the information, only then you can design the precoders, right? Because precoder means pre-coding. Before you transmit, you have the information about the channel, right? So according to channel, you can design your precoder weights so that these precoder weights can effectively communicate, right? Or can mitigate the effect of adverse effect of channel. All right. So this is the important assumption. Sometimes the reviewer asks you questions about why you have assumed this channel state information, right? So you have to answer that how you will get the channel state information at the secondary relay and the secondary source. Right, so let's the signal model for this this system model, how we transfer, right? So in the first time slot, what the secondary source transmit a data stream S, right? Where W is the precoder weight, since it is a MIMO node, W is the precoder weight, and H1 is the channel gain. Right, so the data stream is multiplied by the precoding matrix, right? And then it is multiplied by the channel gain between this link, source and relay, right? And this is the noise is added to it, which is the Gaussian noise. And this gives you the received vector at relay, right? The received vector at relay, all right? Its dimensionality, YR, dimensionality of the YR will be same as the number of antennas at the relay, right? So what this expectation of SH is ID, that means these are unit power signals, symbols, right? S vector S is unit power, right? And D is the dimensionality, which is minimum of M, N, and L. And the noise variance is sigma square, right? Noise variance is sigma 1 square, right? You have to assume a variance for the Gaussian noise. Generally, this Gaussian noise is additive of nature, right? And it is assumed to be Gaussian with zero mean and some variance, right? Variance represent the noise power actually, right? So sigma n 1 square is the noise power, all right? You can vary the value of the variance and see the effect of, see how the ambient, this atmospheric noise or this Gaussian noise affect your analysis. All right, so this is the transmission in the first time slot. I think it's clear. If you have any questions, you can interrupt me in the middle as well, or we'll discuss at the end. Both are fine with me. Right, so this is the transmitted power. As I've assumed that the symbols are unit power, the power of the signal, the transmitted signal after precoding, right, after this precoder weights is, it is, we have to take the trace of this W Hermitian, right? You just take the trace of W Hermitian. I think you are aware with the trace. So WW Hermitian will give you a matrix. Trace is the sum of the diagonal elements that will give you the power, transmitted power actually in this case. All right. Because this is the signal which we are transmitting. WS is the signal which we are transmitting after multiplying the data stream S with the weights of the transmitter, weights of the transmitter, right? In this particular paper, we have assumed that we know the W, right? The W is known, or the transmitter precoder weight is known. We are interested only in the precoder weights at the relay. Right, so let's what happened in the second time slot. So in the second time slot, whatever the relay has received in the previous time slot, it is multiplied by a amplification factor. Right, here this amplification factor is nothing but a matrix F. Right, it is nothing but a matrix F. It is also the represent the amplification factor as well as the precoder weights, right, of the relay matrix. Precoder weights of the relay, right? So this is the received signal, signal part multiplied by S. So this is what the signal signal component transmitted from the relay. You have the noise. So earlier noise was N1, it is amplified by F. So this is the noise component, right? And then you multiply these both terms with H2, and then noise N2 is added to it at the secondary receiver. All right. So for the relay, F H1 WS plus F N1 will be the signal. This is multiplied by H2 plus noise N2 is added at the secondary receiver. All right. Where this F is a N by N complex matrix. F is a N by N complex matrix, which we have to find out. This is unknown quantity, right? This F is unknown. We don't know what should be the value of F, right? And this is the noise variance at the relay, at the destination, secondary destination. All right. So what will be the transmitted power at the relay? The transmitted power at the relay will be this, right? The transmitted power at the relay will be this. Plus, here the signal component will be F H1 WS plus F N1. From that, you can you just this quantity and then Hermitian of this, you multiply it, take the trace, you will get this expression, right? So this is the transmitted power from the relay, right? Transmitted power from the relay. And you know, because this F is unknown, your transmitted power from the relay is unknown, right? Until unless you calculate the F, you cannot calculate the transmitted power. Now there is one more thing. In the second time slot, the transmission from relay causes the interference at the primary receiver, right? So this is the interference power. This is the interference power from the secondary relay to the primary destination, right? To the primary destination. Your primary destination will receive the same signal, right, as received by the primary, secondary destination, except the instead of channel H2, here the channel will be G2, right? The channel, interference channel between the relay, secondary relay and the primary destination, right? This is the channel, right? G2. So whatever transmitted from relay will be received by the secondary, received by the primary destination through this channel G2, right? So power will be same, this power, by multiplied by it, this power will be attenuated because of channel gain G2, right? So this is what you will receive as power, interference power at the primary destination, right? At the primary destination. Now let's form our objective or our optimization problem, right? What we are interested in? We are interested in maximizing determine the energy efficiency of the system. So first of all, we have to calculate the energy efficiency, right? So as I told you, the energy efficiency is defined as a ratio of the total achievable rate to the total power consumption of the secondary system, right? We are interested in the energy efficiency of the secondary system, right? So the rate achieved by the secondary system divided by the power consumption of the secondary system, right? So the energy efficiency is defined as R over P, is defined as R over P, all right, is defined as R over P. So let's calculate the R. So R is basically half log to y. I'm just calculating, this is the rate per unit bandwidth, so I'm not multiplied with the bandwidth B. It's just the same Shannon's capacity formula, B log to 1 plus SNR, B log to 1 plus SNR, right? B log to 1 plus SNR. Why I have divided by half? Because the transmission is taking place in two time slots, right? So half, with this half, it is the rate in each time slot, right? It's the rate in each time slot, or the average rate per time slot, per unit of bandwidth, right? Because B is taken as one, bandwidth is taken as unity. So this is data rate in bits per second per hertz, all right? And these are some calculation, right? You will, this is one plus SNR. So for that, you have to calculate the SNR at the secondary destination, right? And this gives you the total power consumption of the secondary system, right? So you consume power when you transmit from the source. So this is the transmission power at the source, right? Divided by the power efficiency of the transmitter. This is the transmitted power by the relay. Rho R is the power efficiency of the relay. And this is the circuit power consumption, right? This is the circuit power consumption. Circuit power consumption at the transmitter, circuit power consumption at the relay, and so on, right? So this PC not the circuit power consumption. Again, I have also divided by half, right? Because the average power consumption per time slot, right? Average power consumption per time slot. All right. Okay. So now I have this problem. I want to maximize the ratio of rate to the power consumption, which is my energy efficiency, right? My target is, this was the relay power. This was the relay power. Yeah, any question?
Oh.
Which file you can use? Unmute your mic. Okay. So we are interested in maximizing the energy efficiency, which is R over P. And these two are the constraints we have discussed. What the power transmitted by the relay, which is PR, should be less than the available power at the relay, right? So let's PR max denote the maximum available power at the relay. So definitely the transmitted power from the relay should be less than this value, right? And this IR max denotes the interference threshold at the primary destination, right? Interference threshold at the primary destination. Then what does it mean? That means interference by the secondary system on the primary destination should be less than IR max, right? And we have just calculated this. I is the interference due to secondary source at the relay, right? So this should be less than the threshold IR max. So these are the two constraints which should be satisfied, right? So we have our objective function, which is energy efficiency. We have the two constraints. One is the power constraint at the relay, and the second constraint is the interference threshold constraint at the primary destination. And what we are trying to find out in this problem, we are trying to find out the values of F, right? We are interested in finding out the values of F, right? So F is the variable in this problem. We are looking for the variable F, which will maximize the ratio R over P, such that these two constraints, are satisfied, right? Definitely there are infinite values of f, right? Out of those infinite values, there are certain sets which will satisfy these two constraints, right? So from those sets which satisfy these two constraints, we have to select the set f or the matrix f for which the r over p is maximum. I think the problem is clear. All right. Right. So, okay. So this is a maximization problem. You can equivalently write this problem as a minimization problem, right? You just change the ratio, right? Instead of R over P, if you write P over R, it is converted to an equivalent minimization problem, right? It doesn't affect the value of F as well as the objective function, right? Minimization of the inverse of the particular objective function is an equivalent problem. All right. So basically this problem, since it is a ratio of these two, and this function is a this particular problem is a non-convex problem, right? So generally the non-convex problems are hard to solve, right? If the problem is going to be convex, it can easily be solved, right? So the convexity of a particular problem is the boundary between simplicity and complexity, right? So if your problem is convex, it is easy to simplify, it's easy to solve it. If your problem is non-convex, it is hard to solve, right? It is hard to solve. So basically this is one of those hard problems, one of those complex problems. It is a non-convex problem, right? So for this, we have employed a technique or a method known as the frictional programming theory, right? It's a frictional programming theory. Basically this minimization of P over R is a frictional program, right? Because it is a ratio of two quantities. So this can be solved using a parametric problem, which is defined as F alpha equals to minimization of this, where alpha is any positive parameter, right? And for a given value of alpha, F alpha is continuous and convex in F, right? So basically we have converted a non-convex problem into a convex problem, right? And then F bar has the optimum solution. Then the solution of this particular problem, or the original problem, can be determined by the positive zeros of F alpha, right? Positive zeros of F alpha. So our problem is reduced to finding out the positive zeros of F alpha, right? Positive zeros of F alpha. So how to find out the positive zeros of F alpha? So for that, there is a method known as the Dinkelberg's method, right? Known as the Dinkelberg's method. Hello? Any questions? Okay.
Sir, you may continue.
Okay. Right. So this is the problem, simplified problem after applying the frictional programming theory. Right. So instead of minimizing the P over R, we'll minimize P minus alpha R, and the constraints are P R. We have just equivalently written this constraint is P less than equals to P R max is equivalently written as P minus P R minus P R max less than equals to zero, right? So these are the two constraints, capital C one and capital C two, right? And these positive zeros of F alpha, that is this value, can be calculated by the Dinkelberg's method, for which we have given a flow diagram, right? How to find out the Dinkelberg's, how to find out the positive zeros of F alpha. Hello? So first of all, to start with, you initialize the value of F, you take any value of F, right? Any value of F, which will satisfy the constraints, right? Which will satisfy the constraints. And then calculate the value of P. Once you know the F, you will be able to calculate the P and R, right? Because only F is the unknown parameter. So once you take some value of f, you will be able to calculate the p and r. Once you calculate the p and r, you calculate alpha, which is p over r, right? Now for a given value of alpha, you solve this problem. Minimize p minus alpha r, right? For a given value of alpha, you solve this problem. It is a convex problem, right? As I have told you, this simplified problem is a convex problem, and there are lots of methods to solve the convex problems. One is the integer point method, right, which you can use to solve this simplified problem, right? Once you calculate this, solve this problem, you get the value of f, right? You get a new value of f, optimized value of f, right? So with this value, you again calculate the value of p and r, right? Again calculate the value of p and r, and if this p minus alpha r is less than some very small value, right? If the magnitude of p minus alpha r is less than equals to some very small value, that means the f given here is the optimal, and you just terminate this process. Else, right, if this magnitude is not less than alpha, you update the value of alpha, which is p over r, and you again solve this problem, right? So this problem is iteratively solved, right? This convex problem is iteratively solved to get the optimal value of f, right? So the solution process is quite clear now. You have a non-convex problem, right? You have a non-convex problem which is difficult to solve. So you have converted that non-convex problem into a convex problem using a theory known as the frictional programming theory. And this frictional programming theory or frictional programming requires you to solve a complex problem iteratively until some termination criteria is met, right? So this convex problem, for this convex problem, you have a well-defined method like integer point method, right? But we have proposed a method based on augmented Lagrangian multiplier method, right? To speed up the calculations and to control the convergence, right? If you are using an inbuilt tool, you have no control over the termination of the algorithm. Right, but you write your own code for a particular method. For a particular method, you can have a better control for the problem termination as well as how the convergence is taking place. All right. So, what this flow diagram is showing is that this particular problem, minimization of p minus alpha r, is solved again and again. Right. Is solved again and again. So we'll discuss it later on that the complexity definitely will depend. Other operations are simply division, multiplication operation. Only the crucial part here is the solving of this particular problem. So this problem has to be solved efficiently. So for that, we have proposed a augmented Lagrangian multiplier based method to solve this particular problem, right? This part. To solve this problem. All right. So for that, you form the Lagrangian, right? You form the Lagrangian. So in Lagrangian, basically Lagrangian function, we take the constraint into the objective function itself. Here our objective function was p minus alpha r, and these two terms correspond to the two constraints, right? So Lagrangian function is formed with the objective function, and the constraints are again transferred to the objective function, right? Where these lambda and mu, lambda and gamma are the Lagrangian multipliers, positive constraints are there, right? And C1 and C2 are called as the penalty parameters for violating the cost, all right? So once you have Lagrangian function, you differentiate it, set it equals to zero, and then you will be able to find out the or able to solve this problem. Sorry. All right. So we have you just calculate, you just take the differentiation of this with respect to f, right? You just take the differentiation of the Lagrangian function with respect to f, set it equals to 0, right? We have given this derivation in the paper as well as in the appendix of the slides, right? The point is simple matter, right? You have the Lagrangian function, you solve it. I think हमने स्कूल में ही पढ़ाया इसको. You solve it by differentiating, set it equals to 0, and you get the solution, right? Okay, now but the value problem is how to choose these values, right? So you have to tune these parameters. So this is a complete flow diagram of the Lagrangian multiplier method, right? It is a these method basically requires convergence, right? For convergence, you have to select a method by which you can calculate the gradient, and for that once and how to update the gradient and so on, right? So a little mathematical thing, I am escaping it, right? Let's come to the numerical part of it, right? Numerical analysis, right? So for the numerical part, we have assumed that all the nodes are equipped two number of antennas, right? All the nodes have same number of antennas, and these channels are assumed to be independent and identically distributed, circularly symmetric Gaussian random variables, right? So this is the model for Rayleigh distributed channel, right? Rayleigh distributed channel. I will show you how to generate these independent and identically distributed circularly symmetric complex Gaussian zero mean and with some variance, right? So I have assumed variance one for the main channels H1 and H2 and smaller variances for the interference channels. So definitely the interference length is long, so those channels will be weak, right? So this variance basically indicates the strongness and the weakness of the channel. So our main channels are the strong channels and the interference channels are weak channel because of the distance between the nodes, right? Noise is noise variances are normalized to unity. You can take any other value, right? But generally it's common practice that they are normalized to unity. We have assumed that the amplifier efficiency of the primary source, secondary source as well as secondary relay is unity. Circuit power is taken as 3 dBm, right? And I've told you in the beginning that we have assumed that the primary source recording matrix is known. We are not designing that, right? So W, which is the recorder matrix at the source, is selected like this. It's selected like this. It will select it like, it will not satisfy both the constraints, right? It will not satisfy both the constraints. So basically what we have done is PS max divided by total power is divided by the number of antennas, right? So definitely the power, total transmit power will not be greater than PR max, right? We are actually equally dividing the power across the antennas. So definitely the transmit power constraint will be satisfied. And this is IS max and divided by the channel received power, actually, right? Received power. So interference threshold will be not violated, right? And we select the minimum of these two values. So both constraints will be satisfied. Right? Now to compare our work with respect to some other schemes, we have compared in this particular paper, we have compared our work, the energy efficient precoder design, with two other schemes. One is this fixed precoder matrix scheme, where we assume that the relay precoder is fixed, right? Fixed according to this relationship. Again, these two are selected with the same reasoning in mind, that the power is divided among antennas, equal power division, and such that the IR max is not violated, right? So when you have the fixed precoder matrix, we call this scheme as fixed recording matrix scheme, right? So we are both the primary secondary source as well as secondary relay precoders are fixed, or you can say that you have selected these precoders based on intuition, right? You have selected W and F based on your intuition with some system consideration. right? And then we have another scheme, which is rate maximization scheme, right? Everything is same except our objective function is to maximize the R, not R over P, right? In this scheme, we optimize the rate, not the energy efficiency. Our target, our objective is to maximize the rate, and other constraints remain the same, right? Other constraints remains the same. So this will give you an idea what is the difference between the system design when we take the objective of energy efficiency as maximization, when rate is taken as the objective function, right? Maximization of rate is taken as the objective function. Like these two objective functions results in different design, right? They will give you different energy efficiencies, different rates. So we'll compare these two. So this is the first graph which shows the rate for the three schemes as a function of relay power at the different values of relay power, right? So this green one shows the rate for the FPM scheme. So definitely this is going to perform worse because here we have not optimized either the source picoders or the relay picoder. So this scheme will achieve the least rate, right? Then here in this case, this is green. This blue line, blue curve shows the rate achieved by the max rate scheme, right? The maximization of rate scheme. Here the rate is the highest. You see, the rate is the highest. And this red one is the rate achieved for the case when we are maximizing the energy efficiency, when our objective is to maximize the energy efficiency, right? So if we go for maximization of the energy efficiency, definitely the achievable rate is less, but we are the energy efficiency is high. That we'll see. This is the energy efficiency obtained by the three schemes. Again, energy efficiency obtained by this scheme is the least, right? The FPM scheme is the least. Max rate scheme, the energy efficiency initially increases, after a certain time it starts to decrease, right? What happens? Because at higher powers, when you give it, the rate doesn't increase in proportion of the power, right? The rate doesn't increase in proportion of the power, right? So for a given power, the increment in rate decreases as your power increases. But when in case of energy efficient design, your energy efficiency remains constant after certain time, right? It doesn't decrease, and it achieves the highest energy efficiency, right? This is the impact of threshold, right? This is the impact of threshold. So when you have a lenient threshold, that means the threshold which can tolerate more interference power, your energy efficiency is highest. When your threshold requirements are higher, that means it can tolerate very small amount of interference, your energy efficiency decreases, right? And it is natural, basically, right? As you will allow, if you allow transmission with some tolerance, definitely the energy efficiency of the secondary system will increase, right? Any question up to this point? Can anybody tell? I have a question. Can anybody tell what are the limitations of this scheme? If you see from my numerical result section, we have done the simulations for very small number of antennas, say 2, 3, 2, and so on. So, and what are the other things? I have taken some assumptions, right? So from these assumptions, what you can tell? These are the limitations of this work. Then I will proceed further. Anybody, please. No. Okay. So first and foremost, limitation is the computational complexity of this particular scheme, right? As this problem is a non-convex problem, and I've told you these are hard to solve, right? So these problems take hours to solve. So they are not suitable. Even if we are able to calculate the Picoders with simulation time or the calculation time hours, these schemes are not implementable because your channel continuously changes, right? The wireless channel is a dynamic channel. You have calculated the picoder for one channel, but your channel will change after a certain time. So again, you cannot optimize the system because it takes lots of time. And we have calculated the results for SIP 2 or 4 antennas. But 2 and 4 antennas are outdated, almost outdated sort of thing, right? Because the 4G can allow up to eight antennas, right? 5G systems are supposed to allow thousands of antennas on the base station and even 8 or 16 or 32 antennas on the mobile, right? And the upcoming 6G standard, which will be implemented by 2030, will allow 10,000 of antennas, right? So if you scale up this scheme for say 1,000 antennas, you are not going to even obtain the results. Your best computer will fail to give the results in reasonable time, right? So what we can propose, or what the next generation system are going to do, is use the artificial intelligence, right? Use the machine learning to design the system parameters dynamically, autonomously, right? So we have one of my other students attempted this problem with a deep learning technique, right? With a deep learning trend. Let's discuss it quickly. The same system model is there, right? The same system model is there. Whatever we have just obtained from this optimization based solution will act as a data set, to train a DNN model, right? To train a DNN model. So what here is, we have a DNN. We are training this DNN with the help of this data generated from this optimization based framework. And once the data is trained, this network is trained, we will implement here at the relay side, right? With this training, whatever you channel, this DN will give you the precoder weights, appropriate precoder weights, right? And those weights can be calculated in fraction of seconds, right? That means these methods can be implementable. Again, but the limitation of these methods, database methods, is that they are heavily dependent on data, so we have to look for other ways, right? The machine learning methods which requires doesn't require level data, right? Doesn't require or sort of unsupervised learning or reinforcement learning type of DNN models. So let's discuss what we have done, right? So we have defined the data sets where this is the input data set and this is the output of the DNN, right? So when the training phase, this is your input channels and this is what the picoder output, right? So we have a set, we train this network with this labeled data or the known data, right? So for that, we have generated 10,000 samples of this D with the optimization based method that we have just discussed, and train this DNN using this loss function, right? Which this X denotes the output of the DNN, and this Q is the desired output or the output given by the optimization based method, right? And this is nothing but the parameters of the DNN, like its weight and Y stops. Once it is trained, some part of the data will use to verify it, right? So testing, training, and verification, these are part of the machine learning process. Right, same parameters that we have used for optimization based method, the same parameter that we have used for optimization based method. And these are the parameters specific to the DNM-based approach. These are the learning rate, batch size, that means we have entered the data in 2000 batches, number of people 1500, 70% out of these 10,000, 70% samples are taken for training, 15% are reserved for validation, and the remaining 50% will be used for testing. So all these training, testing, and validation data sets are mutually exclusive. They are different, right? And the optimization method is gradient descent with momentum. We got the exact same results, right? The MSE is very low, right? MSE is, we got the same energy efficiency with this optimization-based, same as the optimization-based method. Right, do you see the time complexity analysis? Right, this represents the optimization based algorithm, and this is the DNN based time taken by the DNN based algorithm. Right, 0.03 seconds. Here it takes 190 seconds average time. If you increase the number of antennas, it increases very slightly, but here it's tripled. Right, it's tripled. So you see the time complexity. This DNN based methods require a fraction of seconds, which makes them practically implementable, right? You can implement. This is the robustness of this analysis, right? You see the channel variance, right? Which is quite possible in wireless case, right? Variance channel changes rapidly, is still the energy efficiency obtained is almost same, right? You see these all graphs converges to merges to one and the slight difference. That means the DNN based analysis or DNN based design is robust to channel variations, right? And the channel variate, there's no problem. Your DNN based relay recorder will give you the good or best relay recorders. All right. So basically, this particular problem of relay precoder design is dealt with two strategies. One is the optimization based classical framework. Other is the data driven approach, which is based on the training of a DNA. Right. So this is all. Let me discuss the future research directions. Future research direction in this particular paper. Right, so we have assumed that all the channel gains, all the channels are known at the source and relay, right? Exact, they are known. How, what happens when the estimated channels are not same? There is an estimation error, right? So there is, when there is an estimation error, your design will fail, right? You are assuming that you know the channel, but your knowledge is not correct, so your channel, estimated channel, is not correct, right? There is some estimation error, right? So you can design the precoders with keeping in mind or taking into your design the estimation errors, right? That is known as the robust design, right? So that is one direction. We have done some preliminary work on that, right? Then in this particular paper, we have designed only the source, only the relay precoder. Why not to design the source precoder as well, right? When you design the source precoder and the relay precoder, definitely your performance will be better, right? So again, you can design the source and relay precoder both jointly. So again, that that problem is basically much more complex than this problem, right? One more thing that we have discussed here is that in case of energy efficiency maximization, your rate is less than the max rate. Rate is less as compared to the rate maximization scheme. So in this particular framework or in this particular problem, you can also add one more constraint by which you will satisfy that this is my minimum rate requirement, it must be satisfied, right? So one such constraint can also be added, which says that this is my minimum rate requirement. It must, whatever you are optimizing, you optimize, but I need this much rate and it should be satisfied. So that constraint can also be included. This is known as the quality of service constraint. you are interested in particular quality that you need to be guaranteed by the system designer. All right. And again, all these problems can be solved with the machine learning approaches, definitely, right? Which is going to be, machine learning is going to be a key technology for the beyond 5G and the other future networks. Further, we have a fixed relay. In this particular problem, we have a fixed relay. But in a wireless setting, you may have multiple relays, right? You have multiple relays. So you can select a relay which is best for that particular setting, right? So in the same problem formulation, it can be considered that there are multiple relays and you select the best result, or you select the relay which will maximize your energy efficiency, maximize your rate, and so on, right? So these are some directions you can think of, right? So if you are interested in the MATLAB coding, I can just go through one of the programs which we have used for simulation of this. Can you see this screen? The code?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So basically, the student has worked on this, used a very good modular type of approach. Modular type of approach, where she has a main program and then she has called different functions for different tasks, right? It is always a good practice to comment on each and every parameter that you have used. It is good practice to define all the global variables at first, which are not going to change iteration by iteration, right? And you keep the modularity. So let's see what is this he has done in this main program. So these two instructions are for clear the registers and all that, so it will not affect your simulation. These are the number of antennas, right? We have assumed that they are fixed number of antennas, so you define it globally. Right, so M represent the transmitter antennas, M is the number of relay antennas. You take whatever you want. अगर आप हर जगह define करेंगे तो आपको हर जगह change करनी पड़ेगी values. Right, यहाँ पर आप value change करिए, फिर से run करिए इस program को, आपका 3 antennas के लिए हो जाएगा. Is it? So it's always good practice to define the variables at the beginning or in the main program. Right, these are the variable associated with the power at the source, maximum power at the source. We have taken the term of PR max, PS max, maximum power at the source, which is taken as 10 dB. It is converted into linear scale, right? Decibel power ko linear scale mein convert kiya hai. Then we are plotting. You have seen that we have plotted the figures for relay power from minus 20 dB to plus 20 dB. So we have taken this relay power from minus 20 dB to 20 dB in increment of 2 dB. So minus 20, minus 80, minus 16, and so on. And then again converted it into the linear scale. Right? This dot cap is the function for element by element calculation. Right? This is your interference threshold. Again, the interference threshold is converted into linear scale. All right. So these are the parameters which are not going to change. Right, and this is the interference threshold due to relay. Both are taken as same, right? So यहाँ पर जरूरी है दो variable आपने एक variable से भी काम चला सकते हैं अगर same है तो. And these the power amplifier efficiencies. Numerical section में हमने देखा था इसको, हमने one assume किया हुआ है, so one लिया हुआ है. ये एक parameter है, very small tolerance that we are that we'll use to for the termination of the problems, right? For the termination of the algorithms. This is your circuit power. We have taken as 3 decibels. So when you convert it into linear scale, it will come out 0.002, right? Number of channels channel realization we are taking 100, right? Number of channels realizations we are taking 100. You have to average out the results, right? One realization of channel, then second realization of channel, and whatever you are calculating, you average it out, right? So here you have taken, I have taken 100, and the number of iteration is 10. So basically it is 1,000 channels, right? 1,000 channel realizations. And noise power is given as unity, right? I have three schemes. For all the three schemes, I have energy efficiency, I have rate, right? So I need six variables to capture the energy efficiency and rate, energy efficiency and rate, energy efficiency and rate. This is for energy efficiency maximization problem. This is for rate maximization, and this is for fixed precoder design problem. So I have defined three variables which will hold my values of energy efficiency for each value of relay transmit power, right? How many values of relay power, relay transmit power are there? There are these much of value, minus 20 is plus 20 dB, tak, do increment, so around 10 or 11 values will be there, right? So this length function calculates how many entries are allowed in this array. All right. Then I have generated the channels. I equals to one number of channels. So for first channel, I is one. So this is how the Gaussian, relic distributed random variables are generated, right? It is complex Gaussian, independent and identically distributed. So what you take is you generate two Gaussian random variables for which there is a function in the MATLAB, rand n, right? There is a function in the MATLAB which is rand n, all right? This gives you a zero mean unit variance, right? Gaussian random variable of dimension n by m, all right? Plus 1 into j multiplier random. So this is another random variable, right? So this whole thing is a complex Gaussian random variable. Zero mean, but it now its variance will be 2, right? Its variance will be 2, but we need variance 1. So for that, you multiply it with square root of 1/2. That is very important, right? Otherwise, aap jo bhi graph plot karenge, usme 3 dB ka difference aega, right? 3 decibels ka difference aega, agar aap isko scale nahi karte. To ye ek galti hai jo kai baar log kar dete hain summation mein. So always remember this statement, it gives your complex Gaussian random variable with zero mean and unit variance. यूनिट वेरियंस, राइट? अगर आपको वेरियंस 5 चाहिए, सो आप इसको स्क्वायर रूट 5 से और मल्टीप्लाई कर दीजिए, जो आपको वेरियंस 5 मिल जाएगा. आपको वेरियंस 10 चाहिए, स्क्वायर रूट 10 से मल्टीप्लाई कर दीजिए, राइट? सो ऑलवेज जनरेट द पैरामीटर विद वेरियंस 1 एंड देन यू मल्टीप्लाई इट अकॉर्डिंगली. ऑलराइट, दिस जनरेट्स द सेकंड चैनल H2, द थर्ड चैनल विद द सेम मेथड. हियर यू नोटिस दैट वी हैव मल्टीप्लाइड बाय square root 0.3, because for G1 and G2 we need variance 0.3. So this part gives me a random relic Gaussian random variable, a relic distributed channel with unit variance. When I multiply with this square root 0.3, it will give me a relic distributed channel with variance 0.3. Right? आप इनको भी ऊपर आप define कर सकते थे. अगर आपको जैसे मान लीजिए और वेरिएंस चेंज करना है बार बार, तो आप ये चीज यहां पर डिफाइन करिए, वेरिएंस ऑफ H1, वेरिएंस ऑफ H2, राइट? सो जब आपको चेंज करना होगा, आपको ढूंढना नहीं पड़ेगा आपने कहां-कहां पॉइंट पे H1 लिखा हुआ है, यू जस्ट चेंज इट ओवर हियर. ऑलराइट, ऑलराइट, देन आई विल टेक टेक दीस and I have again defined these vectors to hold the rate and energy efficiency for all the three schemes. And these array has length equal to the number of relay powers, right? And I have taken all the values as zero, right? Initially, all the values in these arrays is zero, right? So I will run this loop for all the relay powers, right? I will calculate the energy efficiency for each and every value of the relay power from minus 20 dB to plus 20 dB. So let's take this first power here, PR max. So PR max J means the first value, that is minus 20 dB will come here. Then I will use the functions, right? Functions will be called, but before that, this is how the W is calculated. For W, you have the formula, right? Then you have F. For F, you have the formula. We have defined that in the numerical section, right? Then I have calculated this function value. So function value is nothing but basically calculate the value of energy efficiency and rate. Once you know the W and F, you can calculate the rate because we have the formula, right? So this function value basically is a function which when you pass all the values h1, h2, f, w, m, ropes, everything, it will calculate the value of capital R as well as the value of the energy efficiency or power. Then you can divide this power rate with the power, it will calculate the energy efficiency, right? So basically this function is once the value of f and w are given, it will calculate the value of R and P or the energy efficiency. Similarly, you have another function which calculate which basically is the rate function. Another function, rate function values. What is that? It will calculate the rate, right? It will calculate the rate, and this is a function which maximizes the rate, right? The objective is maximization of the rate, right? So for this comparison purpose, this function implements the maximization of rate. And you have the third function which implements the augmented Lagrangian multiplier method that we have just calculated, we have just discussed, right? Lagrangian multiplier method, right? Once you have calculated, so initially हमने इस energy में zero डाला हुआ था, इससे जो energy efficiency calculate आएगी उसको add कर दिया, rate आए उसको calculate कर दिया, सारे method के लिए जब इस loop से बाहर निकलेंगे, then we will divide it by the number of channels, so that will give you the average energy efficiency for 100 channels, and you do it 10 times, you have a smooth graph because of this averaging. Those who are interested in this program, I can share this code as well. No problem with that. All the codes are highly commented, so there is no problem in understanding this code, right? And these codes are running. Actually, these plots has been we have just run this program to calculate these results. All right. We have also the codes for the machine learning part, right? But they are in Python actually, and I am not frequent in Python. So those who are interested in the Python course, please let me know. I will connect them to the student who is working on that, right? Python. Thank you very much. I am finishing it a little early. If you have any questions, please feel free.
Sir, can you show the simulation parameters?
Yeah, these are the simulation parameters.
Sir, before training parameter, you have shown one slide now.
Just a minute.
Hey, yeah.
This one. Hello. These are the simulation parameters.
Not this one, sir. For the second model.
For the deep learning model. So these are the basically the system parameters. They are the same as before. So these are the parameters related with the machine learning.
Same parameters, sir.
Yeah, that's why only then we will be able to compare, no? Only then we will be able to compare. These training parameters you have to adjust actually. For problem to problem, you have to adjust, right? for this deep learning model parameter, you have to adjust learning rate, batch size, number of epochs, right? And you need sufficient data to train. I have taken is 10,000 here. Data size is 10,000, right? Which I have divided into epoch, three parts.
What is epoch?
Epoch is basically that how many number of samples at one time goes to the machine actually.
Okay,
right?
Sir.
It is related to the machine learning part.
Okay. Sir, excuse me.
Yeah.
Sir, how do you create the data set for training machine learning model or deep learning model?
For this optimization based method,
sir,
just a minute. I have taken 10,000 channels, right? I have taken 10,000 values of H1. H2, G1, G2, right? So one value of H1, H2, G1, G2 is my one input. When I run my this optimization algorithm, I got the value of F, right? So H1, H2, G1, G2 is my input, and corresponding F, which I obtained by solving from got it from optimization, is my output. So in this way, I will generate 10,000 such points. Right, 10,000 H1, H2, G1, G2, and 10,000 corresponding outputs from the optimization based method. Right, so this will be used as data set for the machine learning model.
Then the data set is implemented in Python, right?
Huh.
Sir, can you share the data set in that Python code?
I don't have Python code right now. If you are interested, as I've told you, I'm not comfortable with Python, but my student is working in a combination of MATLAB and Python. So if you are interested, I will connect to him, right?
Okay.
He will help you. Just drop me an email at mbansal@iiddmj.ac.in.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Anybody else, please?
So on the behalf of IIIDM Gwalior and the coordinators of the FDP, I thank you, Professor Manav Bhatnagar, sir, for his insightful presentation today. Thanks for enlightening the participants. We highly value your association, sir. We thank all participants for your meaningful queries and patience. Now I am going to end this meeting. Thank you. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you to all participants.
Thank you, sir.